So my name is Chris Murray. I work for a company called Intel. You may have heard of Intel. Intel makes computer chips for the kind of devices you're probably all carrying around in your pockets, for your laptops, for all kinds of things. Now my presentation, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself, but also a little bit about why I think science is mind-blowingly interesting and cool, okay? To start, I should say, I grew up in Wexford, despite my accent. I was turned on to science about the age of four. My aunt gave me a book called Questions and Answers, which I thought was really interesting. I was always interested in science. For my 14th birthday, I bought a chemistry set, a telescope, and a microelectronics kit, like a big geek. Then I went studied physics, chemistry, maths, and applied maths in a Leaving Cert. Went to Trinity College, did science of materials, then a master's in physics. So that's a brief history of my life. But when we talk about history, when you talk about the history of man, people tend to describe the age of men in terms of the materials they use. So for example, the Stone Age, the Iron Age, and the Bronze Age. So for the entirety of my life, and for yours as well, we've been living in the age of this. This material is silicon. This is a 300 millimeter silicon wafer. This is the starting material for all the chips that Intel make. Why are we living in the age of silicon? Okay, I'm going to take you on a trip back in time very briefly. And I'm going to start, we're not going to go anywhere. We're going to go back through the years. And as we go back through the years, we're going to start to lose some things that you may all be familiar with, okay? They'll become uninvented, so to speak, okay? So as we begin to go back through time, we're going to start losing things like social media, like Facebook, okay? Then we're going to start to lose digital downloading. That might hurt a bit. Next, we're going to lose iPads, iPods. This kind of technology hasn't yet come. Digital cameras are gone. DVDs. Email and the internet, gone. Okay, we're going back further in time. Mobile phones are gone. There's a nice range of a few old mobile phones. They don't look like that anymore. That's an old photograph. CDs are gone out the window. And now we're going way, way, way back. Desktop computers are gone out the window. And finally, cash machines. Right, and we're going to stop there. We're going to stop at that moment in time. And the question I'm going to ask you to think about is, what year do you think we have arrived back in? Anybody like to hazard a guess? Go on, shout it out. 1920s, good. Anybody else? 1910, yeah, Grace. Come on, again. Anybody thinks it's 1800 and something? Put up your hands if you think it's 1800. A couple of hands over there. Anybody thinks it's the 1920s, put up your hand. Put up your hand in the 1920s. 1930s, put up your hand. 1930s, 40s, 1950s. Few people think it's the 50s. The 1960s, a few more hands coming up there. 1970s, a few more hands coming up there. 1980s, a few hands for the 80s. 1990s, a few more hands. The noughties, right? Let me tell you when I think that all happened. 1983, okay? 30 years ago. All the technology that you probably can't imagine your lives without have all been created or become commercially available to the common man within the last 30 years. And why did I pick 30 years? I picked 30 years because that's pretty much the same age as I was, as you are, if you know what I mean. In 1983, I was your age. So the next question you're going to ask me is, what the hell did you do all day with your time if you didn't have Facebooks and iPads and everything? What? Chess, football, climbing trees, getting into trouble. Right, so 1983, all that amazing technology has only existed in the last 30 years. Why did it all change so much in the last 30 years? Because of this invention. This is a transistor. This is the world's first transistor. This lump, this little lump at the bottom, is a germanium crystal. That was the first transistor, not very useful. But from that simple invention, which won the Nobel Prize, we've gone on to create a series at Intel of chips, which have become smaller and smaller and smaller. And smaller is the key point here. We're making things smaller. We're making things more powerful. That's called Moore's Law. So when I was about 2 years old in 1971, the world's first microprocessor became available. It had 2.5 2,300 transistors on there. And it was a couple of, you know, each transistor size, or the minimum feature size, let's say, was about 10 microns, or 10 millionths of a meter, okay? And since then, these chips, or the transistors rather, on these chips have shrunk, meaning we can fit more on them, which means the chips themselves have become more powerful, so that today we're capable of manufacturing chips which have feature sizes in the orders of tens of nanometers, okay? A nanometer is 1 billionth of a chip, of a meter rather. So our current chips contain about 2.5 billion transistors. So the packing density has increased by a factor of 1 million in my lifetime, and that simple fact explains why the phones in your pockets and the iPads and the whatever computers you have at home, in fact, it explains the entire modern world. So that's what I mean when I say we're living in the age of silicon. This is kind of the family history of computers, let's say. I was born around the left-hand side in the 60s when computers took up the size of a room. I started off in school. I was given my little book around the middle of the 70s, which really blew my mind, and it had great cartoons of people living on the moon and in these giant circular space stations that we all hoped we'd be living in when we were the same age. I really wanted to be an astronaut, you can tell. So later on, when I was studying in school, when I was doing my Leaving Cert in the middle of the 80s, computers became almost desktop. You know, desktop computers started to come out, okay? They were still extremely expensive. But in the 80s, I was looking at a career in science and technology. And so I really wanted to get into this amazing revolution, which we all knew was coming. It was the micro, at the age of the micro. It's not micro anymore now, it's nano, but back then it was micro technology was going to conquer the world, and it did. So in the late 80s and the early 90s, my career guidance teacher asked me what I like doing, and I said, well, I study physics, I study chemistry, I like both, I can't make up my mind whether I want to study physics or chemistry. He said, actually, there's this new degree in Trinity College called Science of Materials, which takes a bit of physics, a bit of chemistry, and it's kind of tailored towards this new emerging kind of sector, which is microtechnology, where you need a bit of physics, a bit of chemistry. Companies like Intel might be interested in this kind of thing. So myself and another couple of guys from Wexford came up to Dublin, had a look at the course, and I did it, the other two didn't. Everybody else went to UCD, because that's what you did if you're from Wexford. Nobody went to Trinity. So I took off into science. I found it very difficult, but I stuck with it, and I completed my degree around 1991, when I decided to go on and do a postgraduate course in physics, in science of materials, really in magnetic materials. Then I got my first job. There were no jobs in Ireland at that stage. That might sound familiar to some of you guys right now, but there really weren't. I got the only job in Ireland in my field, which was in the Tyndall National Institute now. So I spent 4 years there as a researcher. And then a funny thing happened to my career. I met a girl, and she was from Germany. So I decided to quit everything and move to Germany, and I taught English for a year in Germany, which was a great experience. But then I got a job in a university and started working back in nanoelectronic research around the end of the millennium when we got our first mobile phone, which was about this big, okay? And ever since then, I've been working in science and technology. I left that job to join Intel 12 years ago. That's that handsome devil on the left-hand side. You may not recognize, but it's actually me working in the clean room in CRANN and Trinity College. In my current role, I'm a researcher in residence for Intel. I'm one of a handful of people that carry out research for Intel, trying to figure out what materials and things we should be building 10 years from now. And the thing on the right-hand side, these squiggly fingerprint lines are actually silicon nanowires, which we fabricated without using any lithography whatsoever. We've basically borrowed some techniques that nature uses to make very cheap nanowires. Normally, that would cost you a lot of money to make this kind of thing. We can do it very cheaply because we're basically bending the rules of nature to make this stuff for us. It's a very, very, very interesting approach. How can we possibly grow a computer chip? Okay. That's where I currently work. That's CRANN and Trinity College. That's a field out in Leixlip in 1989. That's what it looks like today. Intel have invested more than $7.5 billion into that field. okay, to build a giant factory, or in fact, a series of factories. We hire lots of people. We like people who have science and engineering and mathematical backgrounds. And I've been working for Intel for 12 years, and we have 4,000 direct or indirect employees. Every year we take on more people. At the moment, we like people who have even higher degrees than college degrees. We're looking for people with master's degrees and PhDs, but that may not always be the case. So what I'd say to you is, if you're interested in studying science or engineering, you can get jobs not just at Intel, but in any number of these fields, because these are the fields which will become the critical problems for all of us in this century. Technology, energy, food, the environment, travel, aging, you name it, medicine, biomedical, the list goes on. Okay? What we're really telling you is that each of you possess, in fact, I've talked about computers for the last 10 minutes, but each of you possess the most powerful computer in the world. Each of you. We can't ever replicate the power of this thing here. Okay, this is the human brain, and it's this brain in all of you that we're interested in developing in science, engineering, physics, chemistry, mathematics, so that you can contribute to the great problems in science and technology, which will no doubt impact all your lives. And so when I'm a pensioner and I'm sitting in my dotage, I'll be hoping that you guys are going to be solving the problems for us. Thank you very much.
Okay, guys, so this is the most important part of this roadshow. It's when we open the floor to you guys, where you have an opportunity to ask any one of us. So you have a scientist, you have a technologist, you have an engineer, and you have a recruiter in the science and engineering sector. So if you have any questions around that, we will be delighted to hear them.
You've worked in Intel for 12 years. Would you have been working in many different parts of it, like different jobs?
Yeah, Intel's like, I suppose, many companies. You can carve out your own little niche within the company. So when I joined the company, I was the guy in the bunny suit in the factory making the chips for 3 years, and then an opportunity came up to go into research, and I've been doing research for the last 9. So for me, that was a great fit because I came out of research into manufacturing and then back out. Process engineering is an amazing, amazing skill, right? And you can apply it to tons of things. How you think about a problem, you can approach it from a process engineering perspective. How repeatable can we make this? You know, Intel as a company is all about solving problems and making things more efficient. And, the other thing I want to say is beyond Intel, I've traveled with my job. I've worked on projects in France and Japan and also in the US. So these skills are transferable to any number of roles within Intel or outside of Intel. But really, you can create your own little niche within any of these companies doing the thing that you like best, if you're lucky.
Okay, next question.
What aspect of your career would you say is the most challenging or most interesting?
The real joy for me in working in science is working with people. It's not about the things that we're making, it's the people we're doing it with and solving those problems in teams, and you come out the other end, it's joyous experience to solve those problems.
I was wondering, are there any careers in science, technology or engineering for people who aren't particularly good or interested in maths?
Mathematics was never my strong point, but it wouldn't be very high in the list of things I need to have in my daily job, okay? It's problem solving, thinking about things, being creative, right? These are not mathematical skills. Communicating with people effectively, right? Presenting your ideas, right? Those kind of things. Mathematics is very far down on the list of things I use every day, for example.
What are the most popular careers that people who study physics go into?
Why not create your own job? Right. Go to college and start your own company. Make your own job.
Can I just ask you then, Chris, do you believe a career in or a degree in STEM subjects will give you the skills to enable you to start that job?
Yes and no. I think we could be doing better in third level education in preparing students. And I think it's changing now. I mean, I never took, I quit commerce at the age of 15, right? I think there should be more emphasis on business startup when you're in college, in your undergraduate and your postgraduate, right? I think the way to think about it is not what career do I want, but what problem do I want to solve? And does that job exist or do I have to create it, right? If you think along those ways, maybe perhaps you can envision yourself creating your own job. I often dream I'll have my own startup someday, but it hasn't happened yet.
Intel's paying me too.
Yeah, Intel's paying me too much.
So I think that the answer is that the options are limitless.
Do you not think that our generation and future generations depend on technology too much, and that technology is growing too fast for us to handle?
All these new exciting sciences and technologies that are coming through, once we have to get a better grip on them and handle them better, I think they'll still be everywhere and we'll be able to use them more frequently.
We also need well-educated politicians to make laws regarding the use of technology, and that means politicians should also have an education in science and technology.
I agree.
Right? There are very few people sitting in any parliament in the world who are scientists, and yet all of our lives are impacted so heavily by science and technology. So a scientific background may be the desired career path in the future for our political leaders as well. I agree with you. So, I mean, technology can be abused as well as used, but nobody wants, the genie's out of the bottle, let's say, and how we use our technology, how we use our science is in our own hands.
Yeah, perfect.
Do you ever think that two sides of science may like kind of clash and cause problems for each other, like medicine keeping people alive like is great, but it makes the population grow, which means engineers have to make more houses and less space. Do you ever think that it ever creates problems for each other and they have to kind of keep up with each other to keep everything working?
Wow, good question.
Living longer may create interesting problems, but what's the alternative? I'd rather live longer. And there'll be plenty of opportunities in businesses assisting people who are old as well, medical technology, monitoring, that kind of thing, right? So there are business opportunities there as well. I mean, they say the first human female to live to 160 has already been born, okay? Amazing.
What's the best advice you can give us for each one of your jobs?
Follow what you love, right? Do what you're passionate about. And if you don't think you're passionate about science, but you find one day you're passionate about the environment or passionate about animals or passionate about your sick relative who's got a disease which is incurable, that means you're passionate about science. If you love your video games, you love your mobile phones, you love your technology, that means you're passionate about science, right? All these things, you just have to connect the dots. They all lead back to a career in science and technology. Follow what you love, and you'll never have to work a day in your life. All children are natural scientists. Okay, every baby, every infant is a scientist. They experiment with their world to figure out how it works. And some of us are lucky enough not to lose that fascination, that curiosity, and we can transfer that into a career. We can turn that into our careers. A lot of people give up wondering how the world works. So if you wonder how the world works and you want to know more about it, study science.